Hi, my name is Charlie Gerard. I'm a staff full stack engineer at Socket, and I'm your instructor for this course on machine learning in JavaScript using TensorFlow.js. In this course, we're going to take a project-based approach where we're going to start by using a pre-trained model, using a couple of pre-trained models and different inputs. And then we're going to move on to transfer learning, which is augmenting a pre-trained model with our custom assets. And then finally, we're going to end with building our own custom machine learning model, all in JavaScript. By the end of this course, you'll have hands-on experience using the three main features of TensorFlow.js, and you'll be able to use this knowledge to build machine learning-powered experiences on the web using JavaScript. So at the moment, we just imported TensorFlow.js, and we just imported the pre-trained model. So what we can do now is just create a model variable, and we're going to use it in two different places. So we just declare it here, and then we're going to use it in the rest of the functions. So before you can actually use the model to predict something, you actually have to load that model. It's like, you know, kind of the way you instantiate an object. So we're going to just write a function init. That's going to be an async function. Oops. And yes, the first step, we need to load it. So the way that you can do that is on Cocoa SSD and on a lot of TensorFlow.js models, you can call a load method. Sometimes there's a bit of a difference. There's other methods that you can call as well. But for Cocoa SSD, you're going to load the model, and we store it into our model variable. And what we do next is that because we want to use this model when the image from the file picker is loaded, we actually need to call our handle file picker util method. So file picker, and if you use VS Code, it probably or might have been imported directly. Otherwise, it's you write it here. So you import the function handle file picker from the utils. And if we go back quickly to what this does, as I was mentioning before, it takes in a callback function, because this callback function is going to be used when the image is loaded. So once we've selected it from the file picker, we're directly going to feed that image to the predict function of the model. So here, we're just going to pass it a function we have not written yet, but it's going to be called predict, and we're going to write it right now. So now if you write the function predict, also an async function, and we pass it the image element. When we call the function on the model, it returns predictions. So we're going to have a variable called predictions. And what we can do is that because we have the model available, we can do model dot, and then detect is the method that you can call on the model. And we're going to pass it the image element. And here, at this point, you can either console log it, console log the predictions, or you can also, if you want, import the show result function that's in the utils as well. So here, again, if you use VS Code, it might have done it automatically. Otherwise, you just need to add show result on this line here at the top. And at this point, all we need to do then is actually call our init function. And now, if you have installed and if you written this code, and if you go back to the browser and you refresh, what should happen is when you click choose file, it should, you know, it opened the file picker. And then here I have an image of a little cat. And what happens is, I have prediction cat and probability 0.98. So the predictions or the probabilities come back as a number between 0 and 1. And 0.98 just mean that the model is 98% confident that what's in the image is a cat. So in this case, that is basically all the code that you need to just use a pre-trained model in TensorFlow.js. And in general, even if you use other tools, that's the real purpose or the real benefit of using a pre-trained model. It really reduces the amount of code that you can write or you have to write yourself to actually start and get a result and get predictions. So in terms of classes, to get started, we're just going to train two different labels. I'm going to do the same thing that I did before with like tilting right and left. You can do whatever you want. If you want to do, like, I don't know, right hand, left hand, like whatever, as long as you remember later maybe what labels you actually used. But if I just use the label right here, so here what you're editing is the name of your label, that what you're going to get later as a prediction from your model. And I'm going to enable the webcam. So personally, I'm going to do right, left. So I'm going to hold and I'm going to remove my hand just to have my face on it. And it's like, hold. And let's just do 30 samples. I mean, 30 is fine for me. If you have more, don't worry about it. If it's like 28 or 32 or 53, it's okay. Usually the more samples you have, the better. But it's something that you can also play with as you go, because it also depends on what's behind in the background in the image. Like here, I'm taking most of the space in the webcam feed, so it should be okay. But if there's more elements that are being snapshotted, sometimes you might need more samples for the model to be able to find patterns in the images. So for the first sample, I have it here, 30 image samples, right as the label. And we can record another one. I'm going to call it left. And I'm going to do the same thing. So again, enable the camera. I'm going to tilt my head left. I'm going to record. Oh, well, I have 29. 29 is fine as well. Again, as I was saying, you don't necessarily need the exact same number. But if one of them ends up being 100 and the other one is 20, it means that you're going to feed more data about like left to the model than right. So it's going to impact your prediction that you're going to get, or the accuracy. And the next thing that we need to do is only to click the train button and just do not close your tab, so that it's going to go live in the browser training the model. And it should turn on right away. So you can see here, okay, it's not too confused. If I do that, it's like 100% to the right. If I do that, 100% to the left. If I'm in the middle, you can see that it's like, I don't know. And it thinks it's a bit more to the right than to the left. So if I do this, sometimes. So again, there's only 30 images that we trained. And there, we could do a lot more. And then we're going to declare a variable shape here that we're not giving a value to yet. But then we are getting our predictions. So const predictions. And the same thing as we did before in other examples, it's model.predict. And here, because when we trained our model, we had a model of like four different values. When I expanded the dimensions, we can see that later. But we're passing into it, we're going to reshape, tf.reshape. And we're passing it our updated image. And as well as here, opening brackets, then the shape, we're setting a value of 1 at first, and then 28, 28, 4. So the 28 and 28 is the size of our image, the 4 is the number of channels. And the 1 here might not be needed if we remove the expand dims function that we called when we used expand dims on our training data, and that was adding a dimension to our try data. So here, I think it was, if I don't have that, then it will complain about like, oh, your input data has like only 3 values and we're expecting 4. So we can try it like this, and then we might be able to test out, well, if we remove 1 and if we remove expand dims, then will that work as well? But for now, let's leave it like this, because at least I know that this way it works. And we need to call .data on our predictions as well. And that's going to extract the data that we can really like extract our predictions on. Okay, so it's returning the predictions, but now we need to extract the label. So const label, and we have our predictions, and then we're going to get the index of the maximum, the probability that's like the maximum. So math.max, predictions. And we can then call or get that give that label as a parameter to a util function that I called a display prediction, and we can import that as well from the utils file. So here, again, so we have display prediction, and don't forget to import it from the utils file. And here we could have just console logged the label, but I think it's a bit nicer if you see it on the screen. And what this function does is really just looking at our predictions element and just replacing the text content. So really, not much. Okay, so at this point, we have not yet called that load model function. So what we can do at the bottom, at the end, load model, and we pass it the model path as well. So I think that this should work. but let's try it out. I'm going to draw my triangle. Triangle! Okay, so, yeah.